very essence of civil liberties certainly consists in the right of every individual to claim the protection of the laws whenever he receives an injury. One of the first duties of government is to afford that protection. The government of the United States has been emphatically termed a government of laws and not of men. Howdy, and welcome everybody. You are watching The Defenders of Rights. Today we're going to be covering three chapters, all deriving from the document titled The Constitutionally Protected and Secured Right to Locomotion and Personal Liberty, the Right to Travel, and a Private Conveyance / Private Automobile. These three chapters will sum up Episode 2 of Learning the Law. I can guarantee you're all going to be intrigued, so please stick around, because you don't want to be missing any episode of Learning the Law. But before we get started, I definitely want to thank all the subscribers out there and all the newcomers that are checking out our channel. Please hit the like button, subscribe to our channel. Please spread the word on what's going on, all the corruption that's occurring here in the Columbus, Indiana Republic, and even the surrounding cities spread throughout the Indiana Republic. There's a war going on here, and you know we are defending everybody's rights, including ours. And of course, as always, we want to thank the Lord above for giving us the strength, the courage, and the wisdom to do what's right and to fight for what's right. We thank him for all his blessings and all of his love and support that he gives us on the daily. We couldn't be doing this without him, of course. Before we dive into the first chapter that we're going to be covering, which is, even the courts of the United States acknowledge the difference between a private conveyance / private automobile and a motor vehicle. Before we get into it, I want to kind of sum up what we already went through in episode 1. Of course, the majority... These terms of art or words of art cause a lot of problems for the public. They were created to be deceitful. And so while I was talking about motor vehicles and private conveyances / private automobiles in the first episode, I wanted to show you what the courts have to say about the difference between a private conveyance / private automobile and a motor vehicle. Of course, with every episode of Learning the Law, we got nothing but facts and conclusions of law that will further help you understand what's going on and understand the law as it is. Alright, so let's dive into this, shall we? Now most of this episode is going to consist of case law, so as we're reading the case law, I'm only going to be reading what's underlined. And of course, as you can see on the screen, I have this highlighted. That's what we're going to be going over, the underlined parts. The first case that we come across is Koplovitz versus Jensen. This was the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1926. End quote. The case of State versus Bixby was a prosecution for operating an automobile without lights. A statute of the state of Vermont, among other things, provides that an automobile or motor vehicle operated during the nighttime shall display at least 2 lighted lamps on the front and 1 on the rear of such automobile or motor vehicle, and a person who violates this provision is subject to a penalty. To sum it up, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is acknowledging that a statute in the state of Vermont specifies that there is a distinction between an automobile and a motor vehicle. This is why they use the conjunction word or instead of and, because or separates the two. Let's go further. Next court case is United States versus Johnson. This was the United States Court of Appeals, 5th Circuit, in 1983. End quote. By the time the Constitution was drafted, the institution of trial by jury in criminal cases had been in existence in England for several centuries. It was guaranteed in the constitutions of each of the original 13 states and was considered part of that admirable common law which had fenced around and interposed barriers on every side against the approaches of arbitrary power. The body of the Constitution itself commands that the trial of all crimes, except in cases of impeachment, shall be by jury. That is the United States Constitution, Article 3, Section 2. The Sixth Amendment elaborates this assurance, guaranteeing the accused in all criminal prosecutions the right to a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury. These provisions reflect a fundamental decision about the exercise of official power, a reluctance to entrust plenary powers over the life and liberty of the citizen to one judge or to a group of judges. The Sixth Amendment guarantees a trial by jury as understood and applied at common law and includes all the essential elements as they were recognized in this country and England when the Constitution was adopted. The Fifth and Fourteenth Amendment guarantees of due process of law afford further guarantees to the accused. The Due Process Clause protects the accused against conviction except upon proof beyond a reasonable doubt of every fact necessary to constitute the crime with which he is charged. This means that the prosecution must prove beyond a reasonable doubt the defendant's guilt of every element of the charged offense. Therefore, a judge may not direct a verdict of guilty no matter how conclusive the evidence. Thus, it is a jury question whether the prosecution has proved that a pistol introduced in evidence is a firearm or that an automobile identified by a witness is a motor vehicle. See how the judge worded that? Further in this court case, end quote, the judge must stop with commentary. He may not go so far in his remarks as to seriously prejudice the defendant. The jury's function is the independent determination of the facts and the application of the law to the facts. Put simply, the right to be tried by a jury of one's peers finally exacted from the king would be meaningless if the king's judges could call the turn. So what I wanted to point out in that court case was the statement that the judge made with this. Thus, it is a jury question whether the prosecution has proved that a pistol introduced in evidence is a firearm or that an automobile identified by a witness is a motor vehicle. Obviously, you see the separation. There is a reason for that. And we will come to the conclusion of that reasoning later. Next court case is American Mutual Liability Insurance Company versus Chaput. This was the Supreme Court of the New Hampshire Republic in 1948. End quote, the word automobile in its popular sense connotes a pleasure vehicle designed for the transportation of persons on highways. Motor vehicle, more often used as a generic term, has a somewhat broader meaning and is commonly applied to any form of self-propelled vehicle suitable for use on a street or roadway. So the Supreme Court of the New Hampshire Republic went as far as identifying that an automobile and a motor vehicle are most definitely distinct. They each have different qualities, they each have different characteristics. They each were meant for a different purpose. Their use is much different. Next court case is McPherson versus Buick Motor Company. This was the Court of Appeals of the State of New York in 1916. End quote, an automobile is not an inherently dangerous vehicle. Interesting. If I recall in episode 1, we went over what a motor vehicle was, and it was most definitely considered a dangerous machine. But as you can see with this court case and with many others, it has been declared that an automobile is not considered a dangerous machinery. Next court case is McKentry versus Orner. This was the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1906. I got this court case derived from the American State Reports containing the cases of general value and authority subsequent to those contained in the American Decisions and the American Reports, decided in the courts of last resort of the several states in 1908. This is Volume 117, Indiana Reports, Cases in the Supreme Court of Indiana. McKenter versus Orner, end quote, the employment of an automobile on the public highway as a means of transportation is a lawful use of the road, and if it results in injury to one traveling by another mode, the autoist cannot be held liable unless he was using his machine at a time, or in a manner, or under circumstances inconsistent with a proper regard for the rights of others. There is nothing dangerous in the use of an automobile when managed by an intelligent and prudent driver. Its guidance, its speed, and its noise are all subject to quick and easy regulation, and under the control of a competent and considerate manager, it is a harmless or may soon become harmless on the road as other vehicles in common use. It is the manner of driving an automobile on the highway too often indulged in by thoughtless pleasure seekers and for the exploitation of a machine that constitutes a menace to public safety. While it is the law that the owners of automobiles subject to statutory restrictions have equal right with the owners of other vehicles to occupy the highways, it must be borne in mind that this equality of right imposes the reciprocal duty of managing one's vehicle, whatever its character, with care and caution to avoid causing injury to others with equal rights. Well said. And again, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is declaring that an automobile is not dangerous machinery, unlike motor vehicles, which are dangerous machinery. Next court case is Cohen versus Medor. This was the Appellant Supreme Court of Virginia Republic in 1916, as well as Blair versus Broadwater. This was the Appellant Supreme Court of Virginia Republic in 1917. Both of these court cases say this, end quote, An automobile is not such a dangerous machine or agency as to make applicable to it the rules requiring extraordinary care in the use and control of instrumentalities which are dangerous per se. That was self-explanatory. Next, a supplement to the commentaries of the Law of Negligence, 1914, Volume 8, Title 9, Sections 1118 through 1340. Negligence in relation to the highway, Part 3, Automobile Law, Section 1340, The Right of Automobiles to Use the Roads and Streets. End quote. An automobile is not such a dangerous machine as would require it to be in the category with locomotives, ferocious beasts, dynamite, motor launches, and other dangerous contrivances so as to render the owner liable from its mere use on the highway. This just further validates the claims. Next court case is Hendrick v. Maryland. This was the United States Supreme Court in 1915. End quote. The movement of motor vehicles over the highways is attended by constant and serious dangers to the public, and is also abnormally destructive to the ways themselves. Their success depends on good roads, the construction and maintenance of which are exceedingly expensive, and in recent years, insistent demands have been made upon the states for better facilities, especially by the ever-increasing number of those who own such vehicles. In the absence of national legislation covering the subject, a state may rightfully prescribe uniform regulations necessary for public safety and order in respect to the operation upon its highways of all motor vehicles, those moving in interstate commerce as well as others. And to this end, it may require the registration of such vehicles and the licensing of their drivers, charging therefor reasonable fees. In view of the many decisions of this court, there can be no serious doubt that where a state at its own expense furnishes special facilities for the use of those engaged in commerce, interstate as well as domestic, it may exact compensation therefor. The amount of the charges and the method of collection are primarily for determination by the state itself, and so long as they are reasonable and are fixed according to some uniform, fair, and practical standard, they constitute no burden on interstate commerce. In that case, a direct tax was laid upon the passenger for the privilege of leaving the state, while here the statute at most attempts to regulate the operation of dangerous machines on the highways and to charge for the use of valuable facilities. Also saying motor vehicles are dangerous machines. And it was also talking about licensing and registering motor vehicles, which is what we still do today. Next court case is Sight v. Moyers. This was the Supreme Court of the Pennsylvania Republic in 1945. End quote. The inherent danger accompanying the operation of motor vehicles is not restricted to highways. We may assume that the legislature, in enacting the Non-Resident Motorist Act, gave due consideration to such dangers and enacted a statute calculated to apply to the situation here presented. The legislature has taken cognizance of the inherent danger of motor vehicles, the ease with which a non-resident may enter and leave the state by use of its public highways within a very short period of time, and the burden upon a resident or domiciliary where he required to travel to the domiciliary state of the non-resident to institute an action. The next court case is a good one you want to definitely listen to. Riley v. Lawson. This was the Supreme Court of the Florida Republic, Division B, in 1932. End quote. In Packard v. Banton, it was held that the streets and highways belong to the public and are primarily for the use of the public in the ordinary way, that their use for the purpose of gain is special and extraordinary, and generally, at least, may be prohibited or conditioned as the legislature deems proper. It was further held in that case that legislative power to exclude altogether the use of the highways for the purpose of gain includes the lesser power to condition and may justify a degree of regulation not admissible with regard to the use of the highways by the public in the ordinary way. We're going to go over that sentence here in just a bit. Continuing on, in quote, standing out in decisions, textbooks, and law articles is the universally accepted doctrine that the use of the public roads for the conduct of business thereon is an extraordinary use and as such is enjoyed not as a right but as a privilege. In Southern Motorways Incorporated v. Perry, in that case it was held, and with that rule we agree, that when the public highways are made the place of doing business for compensation, the right to regulate the use of the highways by vehicles engaged in such purpose is primarily to be exercised in the interest of the safety and convenience of the other users of the highway, and of the passengers on the highway themselves, and for the conservation of the public highways. We are further agreed that the last class of regulation arises independently of the nature of the business done by the vehicles regulated. As we have seen, the state may entirely prohibit vehicular travel on the public highways as a means of conducting a business of transportation for compensation. We have further seen that the right to entirely prohibit such extraordinary use of the highways includes the right to limit and condition the use that is permitted when permission is granted at all. Pay close attention to what the court says next. The only limitations found in the adjudicated cases restricting the right of the state to condition the use of the public highways as a means of vehicular transportation for compensation are 1. That the state must not exact from those it permits to use the highways for haulage for gain the condition that the permittee shall surrender any of his inherent federal constitutional rights as a condition precedent to his obtaining permission for such use, and 2. That the state in permitting such use shall not deny to permittees of the same class the equal protection of the laws, which is guaranteed by the federal constitution. So this court is upholding the constitutions. They are upholding their oaths of office. They are stating that there are only 2 limitations of the right of the state to condition the use of its public highways for the transportation of compensation or for hire, and that is that the state must not exact from those it permits to use the highways for gain the condition that he or she shall surrender any of their inherent federal constitutional rights as a condition precedent to them obtaining permission to use their highways for gain. So they cannot surrender any of their constitutional rights to obtain a license. But isn't that what's happening? We have to surrender our constitutional right to locomotion and personal liberty, the right to travel, in order to travel upon the streets and highways. We are told growing up by many people that we have to get a driver's license so that we may go here and go there. And God forbid those who know the law, apply it, and don't obtain a driver's license, they suffer the consequence of arrest, imprisonment, so on and so forth. So we the people need to step up, learn the law, start applying it, and make sure that our public officials are upholding the law. Let's continue in this court case. Motor vehicles may properly be treated as a special class. The state has a distinct public interest in the transportation of persons as distinguished from the transportation of property. It also has a distinct public interest in the transportation of persons and property for hire, whether in common carriage or otherwise, as distinguished from transportation not for hire. In making its classification, the legislature is entitled to consider frequency and character of use, and to adapt its regulation to the classes of operations, which by reason of their extensive as well as their constant use of the highways have brought about conditions making special regulations necessary. The state provides its highways and pays for their upkeep. Its people make railroad transportation possible by the payment of transportation charges. It has therefore been held that the state has a right to foster a fair distribution of traffic to the end that all necessary facilities shall be maintained and that the public shall not be inconvenienced by inordinate uses of its highways for purposes of gain. In other words, this court case, Riley versus Lawson, is amazing. It says so much. In fact, let's go back to the very beginning and discuss what this court says. End quote. It was further held in that case that legislative power to exclude altogether the use of the highways for the purpose of gain includes the lesser power to condition and may justify a degree of regulation not admissible with regard to the use of the highways by the public in the ordinary way. This was well said by this court. Let me articulate what they just said. The court is saying that the legislature has full and complete control over those who use the streets and highways for gain, whereas they are only justified in using a degree of regulation for those who are using the streets and highways in the ordinary way, for those who use the streets and highways for private purposes, the ordinary way. So a degree of regulation is justified for those who use the streets and highways in the ordinary way. And a degree of regulation has to be reasonable. All of it has to be reasonable. So it's reasonable for a private conveyance to have headlights. That way they can see at night, and that way others can see them coming down the road at night. That is reasonable. And having taillights, brake lights, that's reasonable. But having a license? And remind you what the definition of license, the legal definition of license is, and to register your vehicle, and remind you what registering your vehicle does, those aren't reasonable regulations. I don't justify them as a degree of regulation because they're not reasonable. Those violate our constitutional rights. Why? Because we have the right to locomotion and personal liberty, the right to travel. We also have the right for lodial title and lodial control over our private property. The next court case we discuss is Hess versus Pawlowski. This was the United States Supreme Court in 1927. Motor vehicles are dangerous machines. Wouldn't you know? And even when skillfully and carefully operated, their use is attended by serious dangers to persons and property. Next court case is United States versus Chadwick. This also was the United States Supreme Court in 1977. It is true that, like the footlocker in issue here, automobiles are effects under the Fourth Amendment, and searches and seizures of automobiles are therefore subject to the constitutional standard of reasonableness. But this court has recognized significant differences between motor vehicles and other property which permit warrantless searches of automobiles and circumstances in which warrantless seizures would not be reasonable in other contexts. Further down in this court case, end quote, the answer lies in the diminished expectation of privacy which surrounds the automobile. One has a lesser expectation of privacy in a motor vehicle because its function is transportation, and it seldom serves as one's residence or as the repository of personal effects. Dang! So what the United States Supreme Court here is saying, that one has a lesser expectation of privacy with a motor vehicle than it does with an automobile. Why? Because an automobile is considered private property, whereas a motor vehicle is considered public property. Of course, there's less expectations of privacy for public property. For one, there's no such thing as privacy out in public. Our next court case is Yule versus State. This is the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1935. End quote. The legislature may prohibit altogether the use of motor vehicles upon the highways or streets of the state. Doubtless the legislature could not prevent citizens from using the highways in the ordinary manner, nor would the mere fact the machine used for the movement of persons or things along the highway was novel justify its exclusion. But the right to use the highway by any person must be exercised in a mode consistent with the equal rights of others to use the highway. That the motor vehicle, on account of its size and weight, of its great power, and of the great speed which it is capable of attaining, creates, unless managed by careful and competent operators, a most serious danger, both to other travelers on the highway and to the occupants of the vehicles themselves, is too clearly a matter of common knowledge to justify discussion. The fatalities caused by them are so numerous as to permit the legislature, if it deemed it wise, to wholly forbid their use. So again, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is declaring that motor vehicles are dangerous. They're dangerous machinery. Automobiles, which is private conveyances or private property, are not dangerous machineries, but motor vehicles are. This is evident, and also why one must obtain insurance for a motor vehicle, as stated in Williams versus Denny, supra below. So the next court case we have is Williams versus Denny, the Supreme Court of the Washington Republic in 1929. End quote. A peremptory requirement that before one brings a dangerous instrumentality into public places, the owner must first provide adequate security that those who suffer personal injury through the negligent use thereof shall be assured of recompense. In the absence of national legislation covering the subject, a state may rightfully prescribe uniform regulations necessary for public safety and order in respect to the operation upon its highways of all motor vehicles, those moving in interstate commerce as well as others. So as you can see, motor vehicles, since they're dangerous machineries, do require insurance. And of course, those who are traveling in private conveyances / private automobiles, they also do need to have some insurance. But those who are operating private conveyances / private automobiles don't obtain motor vehicle insurance because they're not motor vehicles. And instead, they get a common law bond, which does the exact same thing. And having insurance on a motor vehicle places the policy, the contract, in Admiralty Maritim jurisdiction. Admiralty Maritim jurisdiction is military courts, military tribunals. In addition, commercial activities are within the Admiralty Maritim jurisdiction of the courts. Let's see, in Delovio versus Boyd, this was the Circuit Court District of Massachusetts in 1815, end quote, the delegation of cognizance of all civil cases of Admiralty and Maritim jurisdiction to the courts of the United States comprehends all maritime contracts, torts, and injuries. That policies of insurance are within, though not exclusively within, the admiralty and maritime jurisdiction of the United States. And all motor vehicle insurance obviously is tied to commercial activities, and commerce is strictly dealt with the admiralty and maritime jurisdiction. Whereas traveling in a private conveyance / private automobile, you are operating in the common law jurisdiction. You got to be smart about this. You got to learn the law and understand it. Apply it properly. Next court case, we have the Propeller Genesee Chief et al. Versus Fitzhugh. This is the United States Supreme Court in 1851. Also talking about admiralty maritime jurisdiction. End quote. And if the admiralty jurisdiction in matters of contract and tort, which the courts of the United States may lawfully exercise on the high seas, can be extended to the lakes under the power to regulate commerce, it can, with the same propriety and upon the same construction, be extended to contracts and torts on land when the commerce is between different states. And it may embrace also the vehicles and persons engaged in carrying it on. It would be in the power of Congress to confer admiralty jurisdiction upon its courts over the cars engaged in transporting passengers or merchandise from one state to another, and over the persons engaged in conducting them, and deny to the parties the trial by jury. Now, the judicial power in cases of admiralty and maritime jurisdiction has never been supposed to extend to contracts made on land and to be executed on land. But if the power of regulating commerce can be made the foundation of jurisdiction in its courts, and a new and extended admiralty jurisdiction beyond its heretofore known and admitted limits may be created on water under that authority, the same reason would justify the same exercise of power on land. So this court case is saying that admiralty maritime jurisdiction, which once was the jurisdiction that covered the high seas, is now moving on land, where commerce is most effectuated, where commerce does its most intercourse, conducts most of its business on land through vehicular travel. Next court case, we have Archowski versus Hanoity. This is the United States Supreme Court in 1956. End quote. A contract for the transportation of passengers is a maritime contract within admiralty jurisdiction. Can't say it plain enough right there. Title 18, Crimes and Criminal Procedure, United States Code, Section 13, Laws of States Adopted for Areas Within the Federal Jurisdiction. B. 1. Any limitation on the right or privilege to operate a motor vehicle imposed under this subsection shall apply only to the special maritime and territorial jurisdiction of the United States. There you have it. It's even in the United States Code. That motor vehicles are specifically in the special maritime jurisdiction of the United States. Next, we have Chapter 4, The Use of a Vehicle Determines Classification, and that's very true. This is the second chapter we're going to go over in this episode. Now, if you recall, back in Episode 1, Part 2, we declared and found out that the BMV employees are supposed to be obtaining information from the private citizens. And one part of that information they're supposed to obtain is the intended use of the vehicle. Why? Because the use determines classification. It is pertinent when dealing with the classification of vehicles. Let's start off. First court case we come across is Thrift Incorporated versus ADE Incorporated. This is the Court of Appeals of the Indiana Republic in 1983. End quote. A characterization that the automobiles are consumer goods fails because Devers was engaged in the business of buying and selling motor vehicles, and the automobiles were not being used for personal, family, or household purposes. Okay, so let me dive into this. When we speak of personal, family, or household purposes, when we speak of consumer goods or household goods, we are talking about the Uniform Commercial Code. And the Uniform Commercial Code was implemented within every state of the union. You will find it in every single state of the union code. And it so happens that in the Indiana Republic, well, the state of Indiana, the fictitious federal area state of Indiana, has it in the code. It is Title 26, Commercial Law. And that's what the Uniform Commercial Code is. It's commercial law. And so, an automobile is considered a personal effects that are for the personal, family, or household purposes. Motor vehicles are not. So as you can see in this court case, Thrift Incorporated versus ADE Incorporated, the automobiles were not being used for personal, family, or household purposes. Therefore, the characterization that the automobile are consumer goods fails. Let's go further. Next court case is State versus BH Transportation. This is the Supreme Court of the South Dakota Republic in 1946. End quote. The highways of the state are public property. They are established and maintained at public expense, and their primary use is for ordinary travel, and their use for purposes of private gain is special and extraordinary. The right of the state to exact compensation for such use is sustained by numerous decisions. The distinction between property employed in conducting a business which requires constant and unusual use of the highways and property not so employed is plain enough. Thus, self-driven vehicles are classified according to the use to which they are put, rather than according to the means by which they are propelled. The normal and ordinary use to which they are put justifies classification. The difference need not be reflected in the number of miles traveled on the highways or the weight of the motor vehicles used, but the classification may be based upon the peculiar nature of the business conducted. This court case reveals so much, and it is so true. Thus, self-driven vehicles are classified according to the use to which they are put, rather than according to the means by which they are propelled. And if you can recall, in the Indiana Code, the definition of motor vehicle is a self-driven propelled vehicle. A self-propelled vehicle. That's all. And that's all the courts will use and indicate that a motor vehicle is. Why? Because it's plain Jane. It is ambiguous. It leaves everything open to discretion. That's why. Because it's convenient for them. The next court case is James Talkin Incorporated versus Gee. This is the Court of Appeals of the California Republic, 2nd District, Division 5, in 1968. End quote. Thus, there is a real distinction between goods purchased for personal use and goods purchased for business use. The two are mutually exclusive, and the principal use to which the property is put should be considered as determinative. Very true. So in this court case, they're identifying that automobiles are considered consumer goods, whereas motor vehicles are considered equipment, which is used primarily for business purposes. Equipment is. Whereas household goods are used for personal, family, or household purposes. Next court case is Matter of Winburn. This is the Surrogates Court, Westchester County in 1931. End quote. Household goods is a wider term than household furniture, including everything about the house that is usually held and enjoyed therewith, and that tends to the comfort and accommodation of the household. This decision was followed in Hill House v. U.S., where the application of the same statute to an automobile was considered. It was held that the exemption in the law did apply to automobiles. In Matter of Jones, this court held that two automobiles passed pursuant to the phrase personal effects. The recent English authorities have also held that automobiles are included under bequest of household effects. The test as to what are household effects appears, in my judgment, to be whether the articles are or are not used in or by the household, or for the benefit or comfort of the family. It is the use to which a thing is put that is the determining factor. And there it is again. The use is the determining factor to its classification. Next court case is Henry Barnes. This is the United States District Court in Maine, 1972. End quote. The use of a vehicle by its owner for purposes of traveling to and from his employment is a personal, as opposed to a business use, as that term is used in Uniform Commercial Code Section 5-9.1091, and the vehicle will be classified as consumer goods rather than equipment. Wow. That's saying that the use of a vehicle by its owner for purposes of traveling to and from his employment is a personal use. Therefore, it is a consumer good. It is a household good. It is personal effects. Therefore, it's a private automobile, not a motor vehicle. Big difference. As you can see, the courts are acknowledging the difference. Next court case, we have Malicote versus Volunteer Finance and Loan Corporation. This is the Court of Appeals of the Tennessee Republic, Eastern Section, 1966. End quote. He testified he bought it to use in going to and from his place of employment. It is clearly not equipment, farm products, or inventory as defined by TCA Section 47-9-109. We therefore hold that it falls within the category of consumer goods. Further validating, the use classifies it all. Next court case, we have Maryland Independent Automobile Dealers versus Administrator. This is the Court of Special Appellate in the Maryland Republic in 1978. End quote. Section 9-109 defines as consumer goods those that are used or bought for use primarily for personal, family, or household purposes. No one contests that automobiles, whether new or used, that are bought primarily for personal, family, or household use are consumer goods as so defined. Next court case is Grimes v. Massey Ferguson Incorporated. This is the Supreme Court of the Alabama Republic in 1978. End quote. But we do not believe the definition is dependent upon the physical characteristics of the goods. The pivotal language in the definition is used or bought for use primarily for personal, family, or household purposes. Consequently, whether the tractor and rotary cutter were used or bought for use primarily for personal, family, or household purposes, as Appellant contends, or were used or bought for use primarily in business, including farming, as Appellees claim, was a material fact question, which cannot be resolved as a matter of law on this record. We're going to skip over the next few pages. We're going to go to this court case, National Shawmut Bank of Boston versus Jones, the Supreme Court of the New Hampshire Republic in 1967. End quote. Since Weaver purchased for personal, family, or household purposes, the DART, automobile, is classified as consumer goods. The next court case is pivotal and important. This is the Indiana Springs Company versus Brown, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1905. Please listen. End quote. It cannot be said as a matter of law that Appellant was guilty of negligence for using an automobile as a means of conveyance on the public highway. The law does not denounce motor carriages as such on the public ways. Travelers, by ordinary modes, they have an equal right with other vehicles in common use to occupy the streets and roads. Listen to this. End quote. It is, therefore, the adaptation and use, rather than the form or kind of conveyance that concerns the courts. It is improper to say that the driver of the horse has rights in the road superior to the driver of the automobile. Both have the right to use the easement, and each is equally restricted in the exercise of his rights by the corresponding rights of the other. Each is required to regulate his own use by the observance of ordinary care and caution to avoid receiving injury, as well as inflicting injury upon the other. It is open to all suitable methods, and it cannot be assumed that these will be the same from age to age, or that new means of making the way useful must be excluded merely because their introduction may tend to the inconvenience or even to the injury of those who continue to use the road after the same manner as formerly. A highway established for the general benefit of passage and traffic must admit of new methods of use whenever it is found that the general benefit requires them. As drivers about to meet on the road, each owed the other the reciprocal duty to conduct themselves and conveyance in a manner to avoid placing the other in jeopardy. The law of the road does not tolerate any such inconsiderate and reckless disregard of the rights of other travelers on the highway. The important quote to take from this court case is, "It is therefore the adaptation and use, rather than the form or kind of conveyance, that concerns the courts." So all of those who are suffering at the hands of their public officials, their local government, their judges and magistrates, for driving while license suspended, or driving while intoxicated, or even just any driving infraction, period, you might want to use this court case. You might want to use that phrase specifically. Next court case is another important one. EV Company versus Department of Treasury, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1939. End quote. The authority cited, together with others, recognized the right of the state to classify the user of the highways for the purpose of maintaining, repairing, constructing, and policing the same. Therefore, when the appellants assert that the highways are open to all upon equal terms, they are correct insofar as the highways are used for purely private purposes. But the statement does not apply to the question of classification for the purpose of taxation, for the privilege of using them. Appellants admit that the use of the highways for transportation for hire may be subject to special limitations and regulations, which could not be applied to their use for private purposes. That right there is interesting enough. That's why all of us are issued the operator's license. That way they can control our every movement, as well as our private property. Because it no longer is private property when we register our vehicles and turn them into motor vehicles. Further in this court case, end quote, "The difference between the use of the highways and the transportation of property for hire and the use of the highways and the transportation of property not for hire is, we think, fundamental and inherent. This difference may not be reflected in the amount of miles traveled on the highways, but it is reflected in the nature of the business for which the highways are used. So I want to go back to a phrase in this court case that is very important. So the court acknowledges that the use of the highways for transportation for hire may be subject to special limitations and regulations, which could not be applied to their use for private purposes. So all these special limitations or regulations are applied to those who have an operator's license, of course, with any other driver's license. And all of those limitations and regulations cannot be applied to those who are using their streets and highways for private purposes. So for those who are using their own private property, which in this case means a private conveyance / private automobile, they cannot be regulated as such. And they're not under special limitations as such. So the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is acknowledging that. This is still set as precedence. This is still under the doctrine of stare decisis, or however you want to pronunciate it. It has not been overturned, therefore, all the lower courts, including the Supreme Court, should uphold this case. Next court case we have Henry Hofford. This was the Supreme Court of the South Dakota Republic in 1914, saying the same thing, end quote. Thus, self-driven vehicles are classified according to the use to which they are put, rather than according to the means by which they are propelled. Next court case we have is Solberg versus Davenport. This is the Supreme Court of the Iowa Republic in 1930, end quote. Yet the word license has a definite and distinct meaning. In 2 Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 1976, it is defined as authority to do some act or carry on some trade or business in its nature lawful, but prohibited by statute, except with the permission of the civil authority, or which would otherwise be unlawful. It is quite evident that the charge herein is a charge for the privilege of using the streets and highways as a place of business. The highways belong to the public for ordinary use and general traffic, and they are free and common to all. Such use, however, is a mere privilege and not an inherent or natural right. Such right to the use of the public highways is not absolute and unqualified, but is subject to the limitation or control of the legislature. While these are the general rights of the public on the highways, they do not carry with them a right to use the public highways as a place of business. In the instant case, the law is based upon the actual manner of operation, and there can be no doubt that where a state, at its own expense, furnishes special facilities for the use of those engaged in commerce, it may exact compensation therefor. It has the right to say, if it pleases, that no person or corporation shall use its public highways as a transportation line for hire. The right of the citizen to travel upon the highway and to transport his property thereon in the ordinary course of living and business is radically different from that of one who makes a certain portion of the highway his place of business and uses it for private gain in the transportation of freight or passengers. There's nothing new said there. It is covering the basics of what we have been covering this whole time. The next court case is State versus Johnson. This is the Supreme Court of the Montana Republic in 1926. Another important case. End quote. It is within the province of the Board of Railroad Commissioners to whom the legislature has delegated authority to administer the act now before us and impose reasonable and impartial regulations in the use of our highways by persons engaged in or purposing to engage in the transportation of passengers and freight by automobile. Nor does it violate Section 3 or Section 14 of Article 3 of the State Constitution, nor the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States, securing to the people the right of acquiring, possessing, and enjoying property, and prohibiting the taking of private property for public use or without due process of law. 4. While a citizen has the right to travel upon the public highways and to transport his property thereon, that right does not extend to the use of the highways either in whole or in part as a place of business for private gain. For the latter purpose, no person has a vested right in the use of the highways of the state, but is a privilege or license which the legislature may grant or withhold in its discretion, or which it may grant upon such conditions as it may see fit to impose, provided the imposition applies impartially. He is not entitled to the privilege as a matter of right, and, if he would accept, he must do so subject to the conditions attached to the offer. If, as a matter of fact, no standard of exemption is laid down in the act, and the matter is left wholly to the discretion of the commission as to who shall be exempted from its operation, the act is void. So for the case of State versus Johnson, this court is talking about those who are exempted from an act in Montana. And those who are exempted from the act are the ones who do not use the streets and highways as a place of business for private gain. Next court case is Desser versus City of Wichita. This is the Supreme Court of the Kansas Republic in 1915. End quote. In licensing the use of vehicles on streets, it has been held that the city is exercising its police and not its taxing power. Appellant desires to use the streets for private purposes of gain, and the city has the absolute right to prohibit the use of the streets for his private business, and in case it gave permission for such use, had the right to compel the payment of a license fee. It was held that one who makes the highway his place of business and uses the streets for his private gain in running a stagecoach or omnibus may be utterly denied such right, or that it may be permitted to some and denied to others. Conveyances on the streets for the use of the general public are of the same character. They are engaged in a public service, which the legislature may always regulate. The streets are provided for the public in general for purposes of travel and transportation. The jitneys are automobiles, and therefore are entitled to use the streets as a matter of right, but they are automobiles used in a peculiar way, which sets them apart in a class by themselves, a fact well recognized the country over. And if, owing to the special use, special regulation is necessary for the safety and convenience of the other users of the streets, such special regulation is justified, and the question of what it shall consist of is a matter within the discretion of the municipal authorities, with which the courts have no right to interfere in the absence of clear abuse. Prohibition, however, is not regulation, and if under the guise of a regulation, a measure be in fact a prohibition, it transcends the municipal power. Well said by the Supreme Court of the Kansas Republic. As it is also recognizing the fundamental right to locomotion and personal liberty, the right to travel. Last but not least, the sixth chapter, automobiles are labeled household goods and personal effects. Let's start off. First court case, Arthur versus Morgan. This is the United States Supreme Court in 1884. A carriage is peculiarly a family or household article. It contributes in a large degree to the health, convenience, comfort, and welfare of the householder or of the family. Okay, so you understand that in general terms. Next court case is Hill House versus United States. This is the United States Circuit Court, Second Court in 1908. The Supreme Court in Arthur v. Morgan held that carriages were properly classified as household effects, and we see no reason that automobiles should not be similarly disposed of. So as you can see, those two court cases correlate with one another, which is why I read them off as such. Next court case is United States v. Bomar. This is the United States Court of Appeals, Fifth Circuit in 1993. End quote. We do note, however, that a recognized legal dictionary defines personal effects so as to include automobiles, and we have so used the term in several of our opinions. Similarly, the expression household effects has been construed as including an automobile or a carriage. Also, a will bequeathing articles of personal, domestic, or household use has been thought to include an automobile. At the end of this court case, it says, in this context, it is entirely appropriate to follow Arthur and Hill House and conclude that a soldier's personal automobile is part of his household goods. End quote. Well said. So in United States v. Bomar, the court is saying that an automobile is considered personal effects, household goods, which obviously correlates with the Uniform Commercial Code, which is commercial law. Therefore, anything to do with commerce, an automobile is considered personal effects, household goods, private property, which the legislature may have a degree of reasonable regulations over the property. Next court case is Lawwill versus Lawwill. This is the Court of Appeals of the Arizona Republic, Division 2 in 1974. End quote. The term household goods is broader than furniture and includes everything about the house that is usually held and enjoyed therewith, and that tends to the comfort and accommodation of the household. End quote. Next court case is State Ex Rel Mueller versus Probate Court of Ramsey County. This is the Supreme Court of the Minnesota Republic in 1948. End quote. The term household goods has been properly held to include such goods as being suitable to the condition and station in life of a person and the way he lives, are used by him and his household for personal, home, or household convenience. End quote. The next thing we come to is Article 9, which is Public Debt, Revenue, and Taxation, Section 2, which is Properties Subject to Taxation and Exemptions of the Arizona Republic Constitution of 1910. Number 4, all household goods owned by the user thereof and used solely for non-commercial purposes shall be exempt from taxation, and such person entitled to such exemptions shall not be required to take any affirmative action to receive the benefit from such exemption. So in the Arizona Republic, household goods is acknowledged as items that can be used for non-commercial purposes, and they shall be exempt from taxation. I would like to remind that it also is recognized in the Indiana Republic. We will go over that in the next episode. Next, we have the court case Estate of Douglas. This is the Court of Appeals of the California Republic, 1st District, Division 1, in 1945. End quote. The two automobiles were of the type ordinarily used for enjoyment and convenience, and there is nothing whatever in the record indicating that the testatrix was engaged in any sort of a business enterprise, or that either automobile was utilized by any other person for business purposes. In addition to that, it also says, the court held that an automobile used by a doctor in his profession was not included in household goods. Further in that court case, it was held that the term personal effects, as they're used, included two automobiles of which the testator was the owner, even though one automobile had been employed by the doctor very largely in making calls upon patients. There are also cases holding that the term household effects included family automobiles. Further on down in this court case, the court held that an automobile used by a doctor in his profession was not included in household goods. End quote. So what this court is saying is that an automobile that is used by a doctor for his profession, so the automobile was being used for business purposes, it no longer was considered a household good. From there on out, it would have been considered a motor vehicle, therefore making it identified in the Uniform Commercial Code, commercial law, as equipment. The next court case we have Goggins versus Simmons. This is the Civil Appellate Courts of the Texas Republic in 1958. End quote. It was held that a device of my home, together with all the furniture, furnishings, household and kitchen utensils, and all other chattels used in said home, included two automobiles, two cows, some chickens, and agricultural machines and implements. There was said that home meant not merely the dwelling house, but the entire residence estate. Further down in that court case, it says, held that a bequest of all my personal belongings and effects and all my household and house furnishings and effects, bequeathed a station wagon, two pickup trucks, one Ford automobile, two Cadillac automobiles, as well as a yacht costing $65,000. End quote. So the rest of these court cases are just validating the ones we've already gone over. Next, we have Matter of Burnside. This is the Surrogates Court of the Delaware Republic in Delaware County, 1945. End quote. Similarly, the expression household effects has been construed as including an automobile. Next, we have University of Southern Indiana versus Baker. This is the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 2006. End quote. We conclude that Bolson intended to limit her brother's share of her estate to IRAs, automobiles, and furnishings, and other personal effects. As you can see, automobiles and other personal effects are underlined in this court case because automobiles are considered personal effects, which in this case is private property exempted from taxation. The next court case, we have Brown versus State. This is the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 1995. You can also see Cheatham versus State, which is the Court of Appeals of the Indiana Republic in 2004, as well as State versus Hawkins, the Court of Appeals of the Indiana Republic in 2016. End quote. Protection against unreasonable searches and seizures is one of the most essential constitutional rights. It holds a central place in both federal and state constitutional criminal procedure. A violation of the federal right occurs when a criminal trial court, over an appropriate objection by the defendant, admits evidence obtained in a search that neither possesses judicial sanction nor falls into one of the exceptions to the warrant requirement. A similar violation of the state right occurs when evidence is admitted that the state has obtained by means of an unreasonable search. Further in that court case, automobiles are among the effects protected by Article 1, Section 11. With respect to automobiles generally, it may safely be said that Hoosiers regard their automobiles as private and cannot easily abide their uninvited intrusion. The protection of the Fourth Amendment extends to a person's effects, which include automobiles. End quote. Beautifully said by the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic. Again, acknowledging that automobiles are considered private property. They are consumer goods, household goods, personal effects, which is all private property, exempted from taxation. They are not privileges, they are rights. They are private property that you may have by right. The next court case is Taylor versus State, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 2006. It also says the same thing of what we just went over. Next court case is State versus Parham. This is the Court of Appeals of the Indiana Republic in 2007. End quote. United States Constitution, Amendment 4, Indiana Constitution, Article 1, Section 11. Created to protect the right to privacy, this protection against unreasonable state-sponsored searches and seizures is a principal mode of discouraging lawless police conduct. Automobiles are among the effects protected. Moreover, it may safely be said that Hoosiers regard their automobiles as private and cannot easily abide their uninvited intrusion. End quote. The next court case we have State versus Hobbs. This is the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 2010. End quote. The court made clear that the preservation of evidence justified a warrantless search only if the officer has a reasonable belief that the automobile contains evidence of the crime for which the suspect is being arrested. Most cases addressing the automobile exception arise in the context of an arrest or an investigatory stop of a motorist that gives rise to probable cause, but the exception is grounded in the mobility of the vehicle and its location in a public area. The clear implication is that an operable vehicle found in a residential area may not be searched under this exception, but one located in a non-residential area, whether it be reason of a police stop or not, is subject to the exception. The theory underlying the exception for vehicles is that the vehicle is being used for transportation. However, permitting the exception to apply where the vehicle may be expected to be found would open the door to warrantless searches where there is no reason to avoid the judicial oversight contemplated by the Fourth Amendment. End quote. So in the case of State versus Hobbs, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is acknowledging that there are chances for warrantless searches out on the public streets and highways. And that is because of one of the exceptions. And one of the exceptions is in the mobility of the vehicle and the location of the vehicle in a public area. And the theory underlying the exception for vehicles is that the vehicle is being used for transportation. And might I remind you what transportation means? It is the vehicles being used for commercial purposes. Okay, even the court is acknowledging that the clear implication is that an operable vehicle found in a residential area may not be searched under this exception, but one located in a non-residential area, whether by reason of a police stop or not, is subject to the exception, a non-residential area. So they're acknowledging that a residential area, which is a private area, this exception is not warranted. They cannot use the warrantless search process. They have to have probable cause or reasonable belief that a crime did commit or is about to be committed. Next court case is Garcia Torres versus State, the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic in 2011. End quote. Our constitutional protections are intended to protect people from the most serious intrusions into privacy. And it implies that Pirtle is applicable only for searches of homes and automobiles. As to this latter point, the Indiana Constitution makes no distinction. Instead, the Constitution protects Hoosiers against unreasonable searches of their persons, as well as their houses, papers, and effects. Importantly, as this court has declared, searches performed by government officials without warrants are per se unreasonable under the Fourth Amendment, subject to a few specifically established and well-delineated exceptions. Certainly, Hoosiers are entitled to no less protection under Article 1, Section 11 of the Indiana Constitution. And precisely because the police did not obtain a warrant before conducting the search, it was per se unreasonable. That is, the search was unreasonable as a matter of law. End quote. So obviously the Supreme Court of the Indiana Republic is getting some things right. As of Article 1, Section 11 of the Indiana Republic Constitution of 1851, it is equivalent to the Fourth Amendment. And the effects that is protected by the Fourth Amendment as well as Article 1, Section 11 of the Indiana Republic Constitution of 1851 are automobiles. Last but not least is Meister versus State. This is the Court of Appeals of the Indiana Republic in 2007. End quote. Article 1, Section 11 of the Indiana Constitution provides that The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable search or seizure shall not be violated. Automobiles are among the effects protected. Such a right under Article 1, Section 11 is a personal right of the individual whose person, house, papers, or effects are searched or seized. End quote. So to sum it all up, what we learned is that automobiles are, according to the Uniform Commercial Code, according to commercial law, they are personal effects, household goods, and consumer goods, separating them from motor vehicles, which is considered equipment related to business. And remember, business upon the streets and highways is using those streets and highways for commercial purposes. Therefore, the subject matter is transportation. Now, in our next episode, we are going to cover the chapter called United States / State of Indiana, Legal Terms and Definitions. You're going to want to definitely stick around to hear that, because that has a lot of factual information that is useful in litigation and inside the courtrooms, as well as for educational purposes. You definitely need to educate yourself about the law. And so that episode is going to definitely assist you in that regards. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that ends this episode of Learning the Law. Tune in next time so you can learn much more on how to defend your rights.